try to approach patients, the care that was being provided, and really taking sort of this internal look to see what was happening. And that's not to say that everything has been resolved, certainly in any way, but certainly moving forward and trying different ways in terms of how we address these different kinds of disparities. Because it can lead to, and does lead to, some people, A, first of all, deciding not even to seek care, or questioning the care that's being recommended. There often sometimes is a mistrust from certain populations in terms of, should I do what this doctor is telling me to do? Should I take this medication that the pharmacist is saying that I should take? What's going to happen to me? Because perhaps remembering what happened maybe with their ancestors or with previous people in their families in terms of things that happened. For some people, being afraid to go to the doctor or go to the hospital because for them, they saw what happened perhaps in terms of a family member. And to them, going to the hospital means something bad will happen to me. So certainly, a lot of mistrust on the part of some patients, but on the flip side of that, what are healthcare providers doing to help in those kinds of situations or in the way that they are treating patients? So after the release of this particular report, we saw what happened throughout much of healthcare and especially throughout different organizations to say, what do we need to do? So began to sort of pull the microscope out to look internally to say what's happening. And one of the primary issues that came out as a result of this was in the way that healthcare providers were approaching and treating certain patients, whether consciously or unconsciously, in terms of what was happening. That has led to really this whole field of cultural competence. Now, for me, having a background as a speech pathologist and then moving into higher education administration, I had actually done a lot of work in terms of sort of multicultural education in terms of teaching. But in terms of cultural competence in medicine, that actually sort of followed some other areas. Social science had been doing a lot of this kind of work. But for medicine, again, there wasn't necessarily this focus that happened. So now in medicine and healthcare, now there is this focus of saying, are we treating people in a culturally responsive way? Which for me actually is a term I prefer instead of cultural competence. I think the competence implies a start and an end and can give the indication of once I get to this point, I'm done, I don't need to learn anything else. Whereas culturally responsive care really is sort of this continuum where we're continuing to try to learn about different populations, about different areas. And when I'm talking with physicians, when I'm talking with medical students, one of the things I emphasize is that providing culturally responsive care doesn't mean that we expect you to know everything about every population. But we do expect that you will treat people in a respectful way. We do expect that if you know that you have someone coming in, perhaps from a certain population with which you are not familiar, that you will try to educate yourself or learn the resources that can help you in terms of delivering care. Another point I want to make, and again, the IOM report focused specifically on differences in terms of racial and ethnic background. It is now expanded out and that we don't focus on just those two areas, but we're looking at all populations. So certainly in terms of what are we doing in terms of LGBTQ health? And we're particularly proud that here at UI Healthcare, we have a clinic that opened in October 2012, specifically for LGBTQ populations. It doesn't mean you can only go there to be treated, but it certainly means that when you go to IRL, to the clinic, for example, if you're in that facility and if you're transgender, you don't have to wonder if there's a restroom that you can use because there are those in that particular building. When you are greeted by someone in that particular clinic, they will greet you in terms of who they are, the pronoun that they prefer to use, and will ask you the same. By what name do you want to be called? Regardless of what is on your paperwork, they will ask you that question. What pronoun do you prefer that I use when talking with you? So you'll get those kinds of questions. Ideally, though, what will happen is that all of our providers will ask those kinds of questions. So we're still working on those different pieces. But other areas as well, whether it's religious differences or people coming from other countries or other cultures, ensuring that they will receive the care that they need. If it is a woman who is Muslim who cannot be treated by a male physician, respecting that and trying to help that particular woman get the care that she needs from a provider that does not violate for her what is extremely important. So helping, trying to provide those kinds of services whenever possible. The other thing that drives this, particularly in Iowa,